Now to the next part. I came on board Poetry Center in 2000. Came back from UC Davis, and I wanted to get back to a community of writers. I was part of a community of writers over there in Davis, and found Poetry Center. And Kevin emailed me, I think it was, and also Mary Lou. And Kevin did quite a bit for 13 years, opening his home, getting the organization. The organizational manager, we had a retreat that he organized up in the hills of Los Angeles, I think, or something like that. And it was a few weekends, actually. And then hitting the street, getting big talent from all over the nation, Sharon Olds, Stern, to come and read, and bringing, coalescing that community together for more than a decade. I really have to say thank you for doing that. And would you please now welcome Kevin Arnold.
Hi. People often ask if I write poetry and where it comes from and so on. As I was preparing my remarks for today, my sister called, and my cousin, our cousin, had passed away, and he was very big in Hollywood. He was the assistant to the head of the studios at Columbia Pictures at the age of 25 or something, and then, as he said, he worked his way down to finally being a writer. He produced The Last Detail, which is one of my favorite movies, and he wrote Foxes with Jodie Foster, and he wrote Rich and Famous. And he had HIV, he was HIV positive for the last 20 or 30 years of his life. So anyway, I get this call that he's passed away, and I wrote this four-line poem, and never read stuff you've just written, but I'm going to do it anyway.
Yes!
On the passing of Jerry Ayers. In your 70s, the scenes you remember start to include people who have passed away. Little by little, parts of you die. So, I was, as Rob said, the president of PCSJ for a whole long time. I was going to make a bunch of points, but I did want to just reinforce what an incredible job Joe Miller has done. His Azura covers, they're not just the cover, they're the back cover and the front cover, they all fit together. And I know some museum's going to discover them and we'll have a display of them. And every decision that's made about PCSJ seems to have Joe in the middle of it. He's just very, very helpful. And so many other people have helped. We did the California Poets with Sally Ash, and I see my daughter just. Just so much help. But there are two things specifically that happened when I was president that I really didn't do, but they did happen when I was president that I'm very proud of. The first one is that we brought Markham House. It was actually, I think, the history, folks at History San Jose kind of got a hold of us, and then we made a deal, and we've had Markham House, so we're one of the few literary organizations in the country that has a physical presence. And it's really made a tremendous difference. We used to always meet in Mary Lou's living room. Now we actually have places. And that's continued, and thanks to Rob and so on. The other thing is that while I was president, the county wanted to make a poet laureate. And it was really Gwen Mitchell. People know Gwen Mitchell. She was going to try and make it today. But Gwen really put her heart and soul into making it. I was on the selection committee for the first couple, and we got Nelson, we got Sally, and I think that was another thing that really has changed the community. So those are the two things I wanted to mention before I start on my own work here. I'm very pleased that this is a novel that, this is, I just got it, copies of it yesterday for the first time. And it's a novel that I started when I was doing my MFA at San Jose State, and it's evolved over time, and it finally, this is a pre-publication proof copy. We're going to have real copies of it in about a month and a half, hard copy. It's going to be delivered, and soft copy and so on. One of the things I wanted to explore as I started the novel was how poetry affects, being a poet, being a writing everyday poet, affects the life of the people who aren't poets around you. How you suddenly are different and they look at you a little differently as a poet, and how it all kind of fits together. And that's kind of explored because the protagonist of this is a poet. And I'm going to read a scene about that. There's a woman named Julia Glass who was one of my teachers. Her debut novel won the National Book Award. And she's really been a very great help to me. And here's what she was kind enough to write on the back of my novel. It talks about what I want to talk about today. She says, "What stood out for me was the artful blending of poetry into a muscular, well-plotted novel. The title is taken from a Jane Hirschfield poem, emphasizing aptly Arnold's twin skills of poet and storyteller. It's the rare novelist who can enhance a narrative and move a reader with the use of poems that amplify the story's arc. Arnold was one of those very fortunate writers." Now, I'm not sure I can live up to that, but I'm going to read just one scene that includes a poem, that includes that poem. And Wade and Diana it's a romance between Wade and Diana. They meet on a plane. He tweaks his back trying to carry her saddle off the plane, and she gives him a ride back to Palo Alto. They realize they both live in Palo Alto. He's divorced. She's in the middle of separation. And she doesn't date. She won't date, but they do agree to a coffee date. And so they go on this coffee date at Pete's in front of the Palo Alto High School. So I'm going to read that scene here. Diana and Wade met for coffee at Pete's across the street from the high school where her daughter had just started. Most of the people in line for coffee were dressed for work, but a fit young mother wearing a red Stanford jogging suit pushed a Swedish baby buggy while chatting on her cell phone about a real estate open house. "The lawn had to be trimmed just right," she said. She seemed like such a negative stereotype that Wade said to Diana, "All of Palo Alto's not like her." They neared the counter. "She's fine," Diana said, "relax." He winced. "How's your back?" "It's pretty much healed," Wade lied. He straightened up, making it hurt more. They chose a table outside where they could see kids coming and going. "So where does your interest in verse come from?" she asked. "Why do you write poems?" Wade shrugged, but her sincere interest intrigued him. "The world doesn't especially want poets. I'm not talking about Plato. He wanted to banish them. I'm talking about here and now. Poetry makes people nervous. Sometimes it's not taught well in school. It makes people uncomfortable. I've come to grips with that fact that poetry is just something I do. It doesn't make much sense. I'm doing fine making a living, helping Amelia through Bard. Poetry isn't about money for sure. I always think of those two apocryphal twins, poetry and poverty." Diana frowned. "Not all poets are poor, are they? Even famous poets like Keats and Poe, two of my favorites, were up against it financially. I went to Keats' house on the Spanish Steps in Rome. His final letters, written when he was 25, named which debtors should be paid upon his death and in what order. He knew there wasn't enough compensation for all of them. So early on, I decided never to depend on poetry for money." Then he fell silent. Something about Diana's put together appearance, her perfect haircut, pressed shirt, the way her earrings matched her circle pin, made him uncomfortable. "Poetry must be a big part of your life," she said. Wade stirred his coffee. He wasn't at all sure she'd like his writing and wished she would stop talking about it. At the very least, he wanted to get to know her better before sharing it with her. "How are your kids doing?" She wasn't put off. "Okay, come clean." She looked right at him. "Did you bring one of your poems?" He smiled. "As I remember, that proposition involved dinner." He had said, "I'll bring a poem to dinner," and she didn't go to dinner, so they had coffee. So Well, actually, I did bring you something, and it is a poem, just not one of mine. It's one I cut out from an old magazine. It's by Jane Hirschfield, a poet who lives up in Marin County. He opened up a page in the Atlantic, and after mentioning the title, The Love of Aged Horses, began reading. So this is Jane's poem. Because I know tomorrow his faithful gelding heart will be broken when the spotted mare is trailered and driven away, I come to take him for a gallop on Diaz Ridge. Returning, he will whinny for his love. Ancient, spavined, her white parts red with hill dust, her red parts whitened with the same, she never answers. But today, when I turn loose at the hill gate with the taste of chewed oat on his tongue and the saddle sweat rinsed off with water, I know he will canter, however tired, whinnying wildly up the ridge's near side, and I know he will find her. He will be filled with the sureness of horses, whose bellies are grain-filled, whose long-ribbed loneliness can be scratched into no longer lonely. His long teeth on her withers, her rough-coated spots will grow damp and wild, her long teeth on his withers, his oiled teeth with smoothness will grow damp and wild. Their shadows' chiasmus will fleck and fill with flies, the eight marks of their fortune stamp, and then cancel the earth. From ear flick to tail switch, they stand in one body, no luck as boundless as theirs. So then they start conversation again. Diane says, I like the line about the shortness of horses. That brings up so many memories for me. I enjoyed poetry in high school and one in college class, but I don't need much of it. I don't read much of it anymore. The poem's wonderful, but why did you save it for me? Horses, Wade said. I thought of you. That poem is about a lot more than horses, Diane said. It's about love.
Thank you, Kevin.